He's been traveling across the country in search of the latest climate research and information.
Tom Skilling here now to tell us about his epic journey, Forecast a Fragile Climate. Tom?
Yes, indeed, guys. It's been an interesting period, that's for sure. You know, in my 50 years as a meteorologist, I've seen the atmosphere do things I never thought possible. It's what compelled us to travel all across the country in search of the very latest climate research and information. We spoke with NASA scientists, water experts in the drought-plagued Southwest, and climatologists in Alaska. Their collective depth of knowledge is astounding, and right now there is serious work underway, from tracking Earth's vital signs to massive climate adaption projects. There is a vast amount of material to cover on this subject, and we're just at the tip of the iceberg. Tonight, we begin our series, Forecast a Fragile Climate, in a place near and dear to me, one I've been visiting since 1980. Of all the ice-covered regions around the world, places like Greenland, Antarctica, and the Alps, one of the most sizable contributions to global sea level rise comes from Alaska. Runoff from melting glaciers ends up in our oceans, and as snow and ice diminishes, Alaska contributes a disproportionate amount of the warmth to the entire Earth system. In other words, what happens in Alaska doesn't stay in Alaska.
Here we are, we're at the Matanuska Glacier.
You have no appreciation for the sheer volume or scope of this ice until you get close to it like this.
This glacier is a valley glacier. It goes up really gradual. It goes up about 6,000 feet over the first 20 miles. Then there's another 7 miles of glacier. It goes up another 6,000 feet. It's pretty steep up there,
yeah.
Right? We're actually on 30 foot of dirt and 100 feet of ice right now.
Oh, really?
You are, yeah, you're on a glacier. So we get 365 new feet of glacier every year. About 395 feet melt out. So on average, we lose 10 meters a year off of the terminus. And to put that into perspective, in 1964, the glacier came right up to here, and there was a 100-foot wall of ice.
Trail guide Nick Klo knows every contour and crevasse along the silty ice.
And this looks like it's solid ground. It's an iceberg. Okay, guys, and you walk 1 foot off of our trail here. Okay, guys, that can go down, you know, 150 feet. And there's a little trough that's kind of formed where this glacier used to sit. So you can see how much ice has melted out over just the past 7 years.
Brian, you come equipped. You've got the sticks and everything else there.
Everyone here knows that the climate is changing.
Dr. Brian Brettschneider joined me for the glacier hike. The National Weather Service climate scientist went to high school in the Chicago suburbs, but he's called Alaska home for the past 17 years.
How is what's happening now different than climate shifts that have occurred in the past, many of them?
It's really a question of time scales. You know, even climate shifts of the past that happen, what we think of as very quickly, you know, we're talking still about like centuries, not 20 years, 30 years, 50 years. People in Alaska, you notice it everywhere. You're driving, you know, on the highways, and they're disappearing.
More than 200 miles south of the Matanuska Glacier, runoff cuts through a rocky basin, its source shrinking in the background.
This area, not that long ago, would have been covered in ice.
Laura, tell me where we are right now.
So we're in the Exit Glacier area and headed to a viewpoint of Exit Glacier.
How long have you been involved with the National Park Service?
Since 2003.
Laura Sturtz is the Director of Interpretation and Education at Kenai Fjords National Park.
Exit Glacier has been in retreat, and one of the fascinating things you've done here is you've marked where it was in years gone by. Now, what's this 1926 talk represent?
Well, so in 1926, Exit Glacier was here, and we can tell that by the moraines that it left behind, or the rocks that it left behind when it kind of paused in place.
The rate at which ice is pulling back here is astounding, hard to understand. But 25 years ago, in 1997, I couldn't have even stood here. This is where the glacier was. hundreds of feet of ice. Laura, all this water, all this ice melting, the water has got to go somewhere. Where has the water gone that has melted from this glacier?
We're only, you know, probably about 11, 12 miles away from going into the ocean right here. So the water that's melting from Exit Glacier and the Harding Ice Field is flowing into the ocean and, you know, contributing to sea level rise across the globe. If you've got less ice on land, you've got more water in the ocean.
So if you're in California, if you're in Florida, if you're in New York, you know, a sizable contribution of the sea level rise is coming from the glaciers in Alaska that are melting.
There's a traffic coming up to 47 Quebec, lifting off the east ramp for a northeast departure.
This is our kind of backyard. You know, we fly in here every single day.
The changes in the ice are even more dramatic from the air.
People always ask us if we get tired of coming out to the glaciers on our tourism, you know?
Yeah.
You really don't, because it just changes so much.
All right.
We'll take you over to Whiteout Glacier. Whiteout Glacier's up in the valley up to the left here.
Yes.
It's another one of those glaciers that we're losing very rapidly.
There's great concern here. The Arctic is warming at least three times faster than other parts of the planet.
We talk about this thing called Arctic amplification. Snow and ice acts like a mirror for sunlight. When the sun hits the snow and the ice, almost all of it is reflected back into the space. It's like it didn't happen. Once you warm things up, you change that energy equation. You have less snow on the ground, especially in the shoulder seasons. You have less ice in the Arctic Ocean. And so when you remove snow and ice, now that sun's energy is completely absorbed by the ground and warms up the atmosphere. You know, one thing that can be a little bit misleading is people see all this ice and you're flying over and you see these tremendous ice fields and all these glaciers, and it can be a little bit of a trap to think that, well, gosh, we still have all this ice and maybe things aren't as bad as they're saying. It's really what's missing instead of what is there.
There are natural cycles to our climate, but there's nothing natural about how fast changes are occurring today. In short time spans, a number of the past 15 years have been the warmest on record.
It's the climate scientists that figured out the cycles in the first place. Cycles happen over long time periods. Frankly, there's no real physical way for the climate system to change as much as it has in the last few decades with just natural forcings. It has to be something else. And the only other something else is greenhouse gases. You add a gas to the atmosphere that stores heat, and it's going to do just that. It's going to store heat. It's really that simple.
Nick, has anybody calculated how much water comes out of this single Matanuska Glacier over a period of time?
On average, it's about 99 million gallons of fresh water an hour.
An hour?
An hour. And during peak season, about 140 million gallons of fresh water an hour.
And where does this water go?
It goes out to the ocean.
The variability, the ups and downs you see day to day, now there's kind of a floor to that, and that floor is getting warmer. We can still get cold, we still have winter, we're still gonna have snow, but it's not gonna be as cold as it used to be. And when it's warm, it's gonna be warmer than it used to be.
I'll tell you one thing, you feel your age when you do this.
What happens up here matters to people in Chicago, it matters to people in Memphis and in Dallas and in Phoenix and in Seattle. The climate system doesn't really know borders. So I am concerned, but I'm also hopeful. Things are moving in the right direction. You know, are they moving fast enough? You know, that's a difficult question to answer, but we need more of it.
Dr. Brett Schneider is right. There are some very positive things going on in an effort to move to cleaner fuels and sources of energy with the goal of reducing harmful carbon emissions and greenhouse gases. We're going to explore some of those initiatives during our series this week, which I've worked on with two of the best in the business, our producer Catherine Zink and photojournalist Steve Schur, both of whom
get us through the long filming sessions. Mm-hmm. You know, this is one big interconnected atmosphere. What goes on in one place affects another place. And while that may seem very distant, the Arctic, fact is, it's the canary in the coal mine. Yeah. It tells us what's going on in the rest of the planet.
And then tomorrow, you're going to take it to the epicenter of Earth science?
Yeah, we're going out to NASA Goddard outside of Washington, D.C. tomorrow. This is where they build satellites that can measure the ice to a centimeter's accuracy. Wow. And therefore, we're able to track exactly how much ice is melting and also the water supplies around the planet. We'll talk to scientists there. We'll go out to United Airlines, show you what our hometown airline is doing to try and improve fuels, aviation fuels, and cut down on emissions. And on Wednesday, we go out to Lake Mead outside of Las Vegas. If you want to see a dramatic example of climate change, that lake is down 180 feet, like 18 stories, and it's Las Vegas's primary source of water. It irrigates one-third of our vegetables in Southern California and two-thirds of our fruit and nuts in this country. So it's kind of important when you see the reservoir down to 27% capacity.
Yeah.
It's pretty amazing.
Looking forward to more of your series.
Thank you.
And if you want to catch all the stories in one place, you can tune into our special WGN Films presentation Friday at 7 p.m. It will stream on WGN Plus, which you can find on Apple TV, Roku, and Amazon Fire TV.